Very good evening to everyone here in Los Angeles. It gives me great pleasure to be here in Los Angeles. I come from the city of Destiny, or the smart city, and I hear there is a city of hope nearby. I think there's some connection going on. So I come from Vizag, which is presently the biggest city in Andhra Pradesh, and we are happy to say that we have like some of the best medical technology available. Even in a city like Vizag, you must be knowing that like Hyderabad is like one of the biggest cities in the country, but Vizag is rapidly catching up, and I am here to enlighten you about what are the, as being an oncologist, I want to enlighten you about what are the advances in cancer treatment and what are the latest technologies. Just as Mr. Ram has said, I'm going to speak a little about robotic surgery. It's very common. The word cancer is associated with a lot of stigma. It evokes a lot of emotions, feelings like stress, anxiety, depression. People get into suicidal tendencies. There's a fear. People tend to panic. But it's a thing of the past, if you can, if I may say. You can handle fear in two ways. Either you forget everything and run, or you just face everything and rise. You need a lot of courage to handle cancer. And I hope that, all my patients face this cancer courageously. So coming to the advance of cancer, why am I speaking on the advancements in cancer? Because it's just to take away the fear from your minds, to remove the stigma of cancer from the general public's mind. So when you're considering the treatment of cancer, it has four pillars, or it has basically it's like surgery. You need to get treated by a good surgeon, and then you have chemotherapy, and you have radiation therapy, and you have targeted medicine. So these are like the four pillars, and we have seen rapid advancements in all the four fields. I'll get into the progress that is happening on fronts. It can be progress in surgery, it can be progress in the chemotherapy, whether what kind of medicines we give, progress in radiation techniques, and progressing in the imaging and the nuclear medicine fields, which is helping the diagnosis and treatment of cancer better, and treatment of advanced cancers. When patients have non-curable cancers, palliative medicine comes into the picture, and there are lots of advances in that which give a good quality of life to these terminally ill patients, and there are advances in prevention and screening. I'm going to concentrate on the first three fields. You must be having a lot of relatives, the older generation people in India. You must be really worried, whether they would be able to get the same services that you get in USA. In the Indian perspective is rapidly improving. That's mainly because of the rapid improvement in the awareness, better awareness that people do have these days, better connectivity, then better outreach of the health programs, not just necessarily the government programs, the private hospitals are also doing a good job. And there, of course, there is still lots of scope for improvement. India is lagging behind in research. Maybe if more research is conducted, we can do better, and we can avail better, we can offer better, cheaper services. So due to the better, good availability of all the advances, for example, if a new medicine or chemotherapy drug is approved by the Food and Drug Administration of USA, it can be used in India in maybe 2 to 3 months. So the gap is becoming smaller and smaller. We are able to bridge the gap. So this is the PET CT scanner. You must have all heard of, you must have just heard of this thing. This is like a positron emission tomography scan. This is just like a CT scan, but It images the entire body and it tells you whether the cancer is just in one place or spread to multiple places in the body. It helps the physician in diagnosing the cancer, in staging the cancer. So you almost be knowing that cancer has various stages, like stage 1, 2, 3, 4. Stage 1 is said to be very early stage cancer, stage 4 is very late cancer. And PET scan is really helpful in detecting whether the patient has early stage or not. Because the treatment stage is, treatment changes as per the stage of the cancer. It also has a role in detecting the response to treatment. Once the patient is started on either chemotherapy or once the patient is operated, we get to know, if we repeat a PET scan, we will get to know whether we have removed the entire tumor or not, and whether the patient is responding to the treatment or not. So it's not just that, I won't get into the details, it has got a lot more uses. So what are the advances in the surgical field, the surgical part of cancer treatment? So people do get cancers in the limbs. So initially, I mean, maybe when you all were growing up in India or people in India, limb cancers were usually treated with amputations. That is, the part of the limb was removed. But nowadays we have surgeries wherein we can replace the bone, we can replace the joint. Just like we get a knee replacement, we can get a knee replacement for a knee cancer or a knee sarcoma patient. So we are able to salvage the limb. So that's called limb salvage. So we have limb salvage surgery. That's again because of the technological improvement in the kind of metals we have, the joints that can be created artificially. That's absolutely fantastic. Then we have minimally invasive surgery. I have an entire section to discuss about laparoscopic and robotic surgery because that's what I do. And then we have reconstructive, improved expertise in the reconstructive field, in the head and neck surgery, breast surgery, and limb surgery. So we can make the patient look almost like what he was looking before the surgery. For example, how many of you know that Angelina Jolie has undergone a bilateral mastectomy? Yeah, of course. I'm sorry. I'm speaking in America, not in India. So, it was prophylactic. It's called prophylactic surgery. So she has she has genes which are, she has 99% chance of getting breast cancer if she lives by the age of 50 years. So she got them removed and she looks the same right now. That's after the bilateral mastectomy. That's because of the expertise in plastic surgery. We should really appreciate the surgeons. And we got the same everywhere right now. And then there is sentinel lymph node biopsy. In fact, this is specific to cancers where not just removing the part that is involved. For example, breast cancer patient, we just don't remove the part of the breast that is cancerous. We also remove what is called the lymph nodes, which drain what is called as a lymph from the breast. So when we do extensive lymph node removals as part of the surgery, the patients tend to have developed complications, swelling of the limbs involved. For example, a mastectomy patient used to get severe lymphedema, that is a swelling of the upper limb. So this kind of thing has been brought down by introducing sentinel lymph node biopsy, wherein only the lymph nodes which are involved with cancer are removed, or we specifically identify the nodes which, if they are involved with involved by cancer, and then we go ahead and remove the lymph nodes, or else we don't remove the lymph nodes. So that's the beauty of sentinel node biopsy. This is done at the time of surgery itself. And then we are looking at organ conservation. For example, if in India, if you see, there are a lot of throat cancers because of the use of oral forms of tobacco. Tobacco chewing along with alcohol consumption creates a lot of throat cancers. So nowadays, I mean, previously, whenever the patients used to get throat cancers, that is the laryngeal cancers, they used to go ahead with laryngectomy. So the patient cannot speak forever. So with the advance in radiation, we are able to save about 60% of the larynx. In 60% of the cases, we are able to save the larynx. So that's really, I mean, that's self-explanatory. That's really awesome for the patient. And then breast conservation. Nowadays, we don't remove the entire breast whenever we detect a breast cancer. That's again because of the advances we have in, not just in surgery, we have in the radiation techniques and chemotherapy techniques. So we have moved from the era of ultra-radical and supra-major surgeries to organ-preserving and function-preserving optimal surgeries. Nowadays, we concentrate more on rehabilitating the patient, sending the patient home faster with lesser pain, smaller incisions, and lesser complications, and less disfiguring, of course. Now coming to the advance in radiation therapy. Now radiation, plays a very important role. It is the definitive kind of treatment for certain few cancers. For example, the nasopharynx cancer, for throat cancers like the larynx and hypopharynx cancers, and the cervix cancers. Cervix is a part of the uterus. And then post-op, it also plays an additional role. I mean, apart from surgery, it has an additive role in controlling cancers like the rectum cancer and the cervical cancer and stomach cancer and the head neck cancers and a lot of cancers. It also has a role in treating advanced cancers. It has a role in preventing pain and curing pain and preventing bleeding from cancers. So this is a linear accelerator. This is the this is what is there in most places. For a center to be called an onco center, for a cancer center, what you need basically is a radiation machine. This is a linear accelerator. You get expertise in the terms of surgical oncologists easily, and then medical oncologists. But to get a radiation oncologist and a machine is what puts the center apart. And the advances are in radiotherapy are required because you need to be really precise with what you irradiate. So you need to give a higher dose to the tumor and sparing the surrounding organs. That's what decreases the complications of radiation, and that is difficult to manage without the latest technology. So for example, these are the routinely available radiation therapy techniques. So initially we had the teletherapy, which can be either 3D conformal radiotherapy or intensity modulated radiotherapy. So 90% of the centers in India will have these two, those two at the top. But it's the 10% additional technology which sets the best apart from the rest. For example, they have intensity guided radiotherapy, and then you have tomotherapy, you have gamma knife therapy which is equalized to surgery, and then cyber knife, and then you have brachytherapy, which where you put in needles into the tumor tissue and treat the tumor tissue alone. So these advanced techniques make sure that the maximum dose is delivered to only the cancer cells, and very very minimal or if not no dose is delivered to the surrounding tissue, and thereby only the cancer is treated and the surrounding tissues do not get affected, and thereby the complications are much lesser. So what are the advantages in chemotherapy? So we have a separate branch of medical oncology nowadays that we have these targeted therapy agents. Now because of improved research, we have identified specific targets on cancer cells. So if you give drugs that which specifically target these cancer cells, you're not going to have side effects. For example, all the side effects of chemotherapy are just because the medicine that you give just acts not only on the cancer cells, it also acts on the normal tissues of the body. That's the entire reason for the complications. And when you give targeted therapy, many of them are just oral agents. That means you just have to take tablets, whereas chemotherapy agents are more or less, most of them are given intravenous. Pain associated with injecting the drugs, and the side effects are next to nil for these targeted agents. So that's about the advance in the medical oncology field. And then you come, so what is the necessity for an onco center? I mean, why can't you get treated by a surgical oncologist? A good surgeon who does a good job, and then you can go to some other patient for some other center for radiation, and then if the patient requires medical chemotherapy, then you go for other centers. So a good team is very important for deciding the getting a good outcome, and multidisciplinary teams are very essential in the field of oncology. That's why it's very difficult to set up an a successful cancer center. So an onco center will should ideally have a referring general physician, then a medical oncologist, a radiation oncologist, needs a psychologist for good counseling for the patient, and for the rehabilitating the patient we need a good physiotherapist, an occupational therapist, and research is the way forward, so we need research assistants, and then a surgeon, of course, for doing the surgery. And radiologists and nuclear medicine doctors are very important in diagnosing and staging these patients. So it's not one man's job for curing a cancer, for example in this case a breast cancer. So many people are involved, and when they all come together, that's where an onco center that's how an onco center works. And very interestingly, cancer nowadays is treated as per guidelines, because you have so many people involved. If you don't standardize the treatment of care, it's going to be tough. So most of us in India still follow the American guidelines, either the National Comprehensive Cancer Network guidelines or the American Society of Clinical Oncology guidelines. When our students are asked about treatment of cancer, we generally quote these guidelines and we try to stick to these guidelines, so thereby making the standard of care uniform. And there are the European guidelines, the European Society for Medical Oncology guidelines and the National Institute guidelines in Europe. So that's what this is what the onco centers bring to the table. They centralize the care, and because of the availability of multidisciplinary teams and adherence to protocols, the entire unit is more experienced, thereby improving the outcomes and better quality of life. It also helps in research and better training. So this is where I work. This is Mahatma Gandhi Cancer Hospital and Research Institute in Vizag. For any of you are from Vizag, this is located in MVP Colony, that's like the heart of Vizag. And we happen to be the largest onco center in the entire state of Andhra Pradesh. And we also have the highest number of oncologists. So we have a big team to provide the cutting edge technology. So we have started robotic surgery services about 4 months back, and for the first time in Andhra Pradesh, the surgical robot, the Da Vinci robot, was made available in our hospital. So this is our team. We have 3 surgical oncologists, 4 radiation oncologists, a medical oncologist, a gynec oncologist. We have nuclear medicine physicians, we have palliative care physicians, and pain specialists. And we take a decision in a tumor board. So except for the most of the decisions, like whether the patient has to undergo surgery first or chemotherapy first or radiation first, all this is decided by the team of doctors. It's a complicated field, cancer field. It's not like one, you get a problem, you go in and get operated or take a medicine and come back. It takes sustained effort from the team of doctors. So, and it's also critical to take, the right decision and to improve the survival of the patient. Coming away from the cancer therapy part, I'm trying to focus on robotic surgery. This is just to increase the awareness about robotic surgery. If anybody has undergone open surgeries, they understand the pain that patients go through, the prolonged hospitalization, and even after the patient gets discharged, it takes a few weeks or months for the patient to recover. So robotic surgery is a type of minimally invasive surgery, and the first robo, the robotic program was funded by the NASA, and the company called Intuitive Surgicals. It made the first robo, and it got FDA clearance for surgery in 1995. So there are basically three eras of robotics, I mean, of surgery. First was the open era, so far, I mean, till maybe till late 80s, till 1990, almost everybody used to undergo open surgery. Then the era of laparoscopic surgery, maybe the last decade of the last century, and the first 5 years of this century, wherein you put in smaller incisions, you put in small holes, 5 mm or a centimeter hole, and you put in instruments through these holes and then operate. Of course, then came the robotic surgery, which is a step ahead of laparoscopic surgery. So these two are called as the minimally invasive surgery. So this is self-explanatory. This is an open surgery wound. You have a big incision, big scar. You can imagine the amount of pain. And also, once the patient gets discharged, for a long time, these patients tend to have some amount of chronic pain. Some patients are lucky, they don't have anything. Some patients are unlucky, they tend to have adhesions where the intestine or gets stuck to the underneath the scar and leads to a lot of pain. So here, if you can see the image, if it's clear, you have smaller holes, and these patients get discharged maybe a day or two after surgery. Then they tend to do very well, and there are no long-term complications once they're discharged. So what do we do in laparoscopic surgery and what do we do in robotic surgery? So just like in the first image, you put in various ports, they're called the ports or the trocars, and you put in instruments through that into the abdomen. So laparoscopic surgery or robotic surgery come into the picture only when the surgery is done inside the abdomen or inside the chest. So for in this case, inside the abdomen, and through them the instruments are put, and then there is one person holding what is called as the camera, and then the image is seen on the TV that's there, and the surgeon, with the help of two instruments and a surgical assistant, they do the surgery. Now with the robotic surgery, the thing is different. For example, once you put in the ports and trocars, just like in laparoscopic surgery, and it's connected to a robo. So the machine at the center is the robo, and the surgeon sits at a separate console. You can see him sitting comfortably in a chair, and he operates just like you play a video game. He sits in the console and operates. And for the rest of the people, they have separate video, there are some more screens for them to follow the surgery and help the surgeon in the surgery. So here, the surgeon controls the camera. He also controls the assistant instruments. So he does the job of three people. He does his own job, that is operate. He also does the job of the cameraman. He also does the job of the surgical assistant. And he does a very good job at that, because the robo is very stable. I mean, if your surgical assistant or the cameraman is inattentive, or if he's not experienced, he won't do a good job of holding the camera. If a surgical assistant is not experienced, he won't do a good job of holding the organs that are supposed to be held. So, what are the other advantages? So, the surgeon has what is called as the intuitive motion. So, intuitive motion means whatever the surgeon does at the console, that the same movements are replicated precisely on the patient. And then you have three-dimensional high definition vision with 10 times magnification. So when you see better, you can operate better. It's self-explanatory. And then you have endorest instrumentation, which is the biggest drawback of laparoscopic surgery. For example, in laparoscopic surgery, you have only two-dimensional movement. You can either move like this or you can move like this. You can't do this. So, and you can't do this. So that's what the robot does. It has its better maneuverability. And if there are two consoles, you can even train your assistant surgeon better. You can make him do some steps, and then you can take over the surgery whenever required. So this is about the range of motion. It's called it has 7 degrees of motion. It just replicates the movement of our hand. So summarizing the advantages, vision magnification, increased depth perception, of course that comes with the three-dimensional imaging, and then it's laparoscopy is mostly counterintuitive. So for example, if you have to lift something, you have to actually depress the instrument. So that's called a counterintuitive. Whereas when we do open surgery, we do an intuitive motion. That's what we do, what we want we do. If you have to go down, we take the hands down. If we want to go up, we take our hands up. So that's a very significant advantage. It is very easy for even open surgeons to become robotic surgeons that way, and it eliminates the need for an assistant, and eliminates the chance of a tremor, because if you have a tremor, I mean, especially this comes in when you are operating for a long time. When you, for us, we have in onco-surgery especially, we have prolonged surgeries. The surgery on the pancreas called the Whipple surgery, we take around 6 to 8 hours to do it, and it's, of course, the element of fatigue comes in. So when you use the robo, you are seated comfortably in an ergonomically comfortable position, and it's very easy to perform the prolonged surgeries. It allows for easier suturing. Suturing is easier because of the better maneuverability of the instruments and more complex dissections, and surgeons tend to get more proficient with robotics and with lesser number of cases. That's the learning curve is smaller, shorter. Hence, there is better precision, there are lesser complications, less amount of blood loss, blood transfusions required, and then there is significantly reduced conversion rate. That is, whenever with laparoscopic surgery, because of the longer operating times and difficulty in maneuvering in difficult places where the vision is less, surgeons tend to become tired, and there are more intraoperative complications, and then they tend to open up the patient for doing a proper surgery. So this is decreased with robotic surgery, and for the morbidly obese patient with a very high BMI, this is the best option. Laparoscopic surgeries tend to be very difficult. Even open surgeries are very difficult because you don't have adequate exposure in difficult fields, and then it has a shorter learning curve. So there are some more technologies coming up in robotic surgery. What is very interesting and what we need to watch out in the field for is the single port surgery, the image. So instead of even putting 4 or 5 ports, you can put in a single port, just a 2 centimeter incision, and you can put in all the instruments through that, and then you can do the surgery. So one hole is better than 4 or 5 holes. It's not yet available. It will take maybe around 3 to 5 years for the company to develop that, and maybe then we will get to see this, and maybe I'll get to operate on this. So what does it bring for the patient? So far I've been speaking about the surgeon comfort. So in surgery, as far as the patient is concerned, you have to look at 2 things. Is the surgery effective, and is the surgery less invasive? I mean, so if the surgery is really efficacious but very less invasive, it is, the patient is really comfortable. So open surgery, it's effective, we don't deny that, but the invasiveness, it's very invasive. Whereas with the robotic surgery, I mean, the patient is in a very comfortable zone because of the lesser number of incisions and what I have explained earlier. So coming to clinical evaluation, this is the entire list of surgeries which have been FDA approved, and where it has been proven that robotic surgery is safe and better for the patient in terms of outcomes. So the list is ever growing as the research, as people tend to do more and more cancer surgeries, the list will become bigger and bigger. And So this is in the US. So the smallest robotic patient weighed 6 pounds. You can see the kid over there. And an obese patient who underwent a gastric band weighed 576 pounds. Robotic surgery makes it possible. You can't do laparoscopic surgery on the 6 pound patient. And you can't do laparoscopic surgery on the 576 pound patient because your instruments will simply not reach, and or they will break because of the weight of the patient. So that's the beauty of it. We can do prolonged surgeries also. That's it. I have so much to be thankful for. First of all, Mr. Ram and the TASC members who facilitated this in a very, very short time, and my aunt and uncle, Dr. The Mullangis, who were very kind enough to sponsor this, and my other aunt, Dr. Sunita, and her family for making this trip of LA really pleasurable and enjoyable. That's it. Thank you. I'll be happy to receive any questions that you have.
You were comparing with the laparoscopic, right? So what we were hearing in many of the cases was, I'm not from the medical field, don't mind if I use any, okay? So sometimes there will be some incidents like the doctor said the surgery as a laparoscopic for removal of uterus or whatever, because of the fat layers or whatever you explained before, there couldn't be any choice of doing that, and they usually open the in the operation theater. So do you have any possibilities of while decided with the robotic?
Fundamental problem with the certain patients, if they have multiple open surgeries previously, then either the intestine or what we call the omentum or the fat gets adherent to the that part of the scar. So that is the reason people are not able to perform laparoscopic surgery in these patients. So if you are able to take down the adhesions, experienced surgeons do surgeries even in the patients who have undergone multiple previous open surgeries. If you are able to do a good job of taking down the adhesions, and then you can put in the ports and do the robotic surgery. You have to put in the the camera port inside, and then only we can decide whether we can actually do the robotic or laparoscopic surgery. So it depends. It depends on the number of incisions. It cannot be predefined. We have to decide on the table itself. This kind of problem is becoming lesser and lesser because of the better expertise. The initial trainee surgeons don't do these kind of cases. It's only the experienced surgeons who are able to do this kind of, even if there are multiple adhesions, most of the cases, in 80% of the cases, we are able to take down these adhesions and then do surgery, robotic surgery.
Usually when there is a open surgery performing, pathologists will be along with them, and they'll decide if anything cancerous cells and spread it towards the other parts, to the gallbladder or whatever it is. So what is the scope of doing the robotic surgery? Because doctor and pathologist can look into that, and they can feel, a pathologist can identify the cells if they are cancerous or not. But while doing the robotic surgery from outside, that part cannot be covered, right?
Pathologist needs a specimen. You have to remove that uterus out and see if it has cancer or not, and then you do lymph node surgery. So you can do the same here also. You can remove the uterus and then cut open the specimen, and the pathologist sees under a microscope, decides if there are cancer cells or how far the cancer cells have progressed, and depending on that, there are other decisions which are taken. And in fact, you can see the rest of the abdomen better with robotic surgery rather than with an open surgery, because
so you are confirming that there is no way the pathologist can suspect the cells, some of them are cancerous, while doing the open surgery around.
No, it's equal. It's the same. You have to remove that. If you're suspecting a cancer in the uterus, it has to be removed, cut open, and seen.
For example, the uterus is like this.
Okay.
And, uterus spreading to the other areas takes a lot of years.
Yes.
Even that years are passed, so it is starting to the outside endometrium.
Yes.
So
it's the same. Whatever you see,
He'll think of only taking out the uterus. Right? He doesn't.
Your vision is even better when you are operating with a robo or with a lab. Your vision is even better. You get a three-dimensional field, and you can go and see into the crevices. What is behind some organ? So this is. better, I mean, in that way. It's a lot of trust-based medicine rather. It's called eminence-based medicine. We should follow evidence-based medicine. What is the evidence? So that's why I am stressing on the guidelines. So the guidelines have been formulated after a lot of research. So we follow evidence-based guidelines. That's why, I should say that's the difference between US and India. You follow evidence-based guidelines, there we follow eminence-based guidelines or your experience-based, personal experience-based guidelines, which is not always the correct way to go about it.
But for some laparoscopic surgeries, time takes longer. Surgery operation times take longer with laparoscopic. For robotic surgery, does the timeline change?
See, for any surgery, if you ask, it's actually as your experience grows, you do surgeries faster. So it's the same with robotic surgery. With robotic versus laparoscopic surgery, initially what you call, you connect the ports to the robo. That takes maybe 15 minutes or 20 minutes. And once it is done, in fact, you're in a more comfortable position. So you will tend to finish that surgery faster if you do robotic surgery. That's all. It's all experience.
So the day comes where a robotic surgeon be at home and operate
from home. It's not appropriate.
It's not fair, only such engineers can work from home.
No, that I think engineers can still be happy because that day will not come. Because see, if I work, I can technically, what you're saying is right. But if there is a complication or some bleeding or something, which does happen maybe in 200 cases or 300 cases, you need to have a surgeon there, an equally competent surgeon at least. So you cannot promise that. So that day will not come.
I think my question is, other than jokes apart, let us say you are doing surgery in India, but there is this specific surgery, nobody can do it. Somebody from US can still do the surgery in India, while if there is a complication, there should always be a surgeon.
Of course.
To make sure that there is no complication.
There definitely.
Can that be a vision?
Yeah, that can be. It has been done. They have operated from transatlantic surgery was done in the beginning of Da Vinci. I don't know which year that was. There was a surgeon operating from US on a patient in Europe. But of course, there was an equally competent surgeon who could have finished the surgery on his own in the open technique if that surgery had to be converted to an open surgery for this thing. But of course, the ethical and legal viewpoints, those constraints will always be there, especially.
How much evidence do we have that robotic surgery compared to the laparoscopic surgery lowers the chances for infection, whether hospital acquired or otherwise, and also lower the chances for readmitting to the hospital?
So certain parts where the best evidence is there for certain surgeries. For example, the pelvic surgeries, so the prostatectomy, for the prostate surgery, it's a very technical. In fact, Americans stopped doing prostate surgeries and they were doing only, they were preferring to give radiation. When the robot came in, it improved the precision of removing the prostate alone, preserving the neurovascular structures which are nearby, thereby improving the, preventing erectile dysfunction. So, a lot of patients previously, when you do an open surgery or a laparoscopic surgery, because the vision is not that great, they used to be trauma to these organs and there used to be erectile dysfunction and similar. So, robotic surgery really revolutionized prosthetic surgery. So, that is being translated into all the other. See, it's self-explanatory. Which would you prefer to go in a Maruti 800 or a BMW? With all the comfort and. So, it's good for the surgeon. It definitely translates into the improvement for the patient. And it has been proven, with evidence, that there are lesser complications, there is lesser conversion rate. Faster discharge, better so all these are lesser in prostate surgeries and pelvic surgeries, other pelvic surgeries, for example, rectal surgery and then uterine surgery. So that has been proven. So as evidence grows, it'll slowly spread to the other parts of the, it'll be helpful. Even it's a very recent evidence that has come up in esophageal surgeries, that is a foot pipe surgery, that it is better for clearing the cancerous lymph nodes.
That is because of better vision?
Multiple things, all the things that I've cited. Better vision is one thing. And you also have, because of the better optic technology, I mean, that's still coming up, that's becoming popular in America. You can even decide whether this has cancer cells or not. It's still in research, but that'll come up maybe in a few years.
Just to be a devil's advocate, mm-hmm. is there a downside with robotic surgery compared to others?
In the initial part, when the technology was in the beginning part, when the robot was not so perfect, there used to be accidents where they have, which has created like injuries inside the abdomen to other uninvolved parts. So that used to happen, but that's very, very minimal, next to nothing. The other downside is if it breaks down, which is with any machine, you can't expect it to continue. Then we have to go on to laparoscopic surgery or an open surgery. And the cost. I forgot the most important. That's the practical problem. Yeah. It is interesting to hear. I heard from Dr. Siv Prasad, who is also a robotic surgeon, that there is no special coverage for insurance coverage for robotic surgeries. So whether you do an open surgery in America or the robotic surgery, people will. The hospital or the surgeon earns the same amount, if I am right. So what's the incentive? So. Yeah, maybe if you can explain.
I just want to make one comment. Some of the questions you received. I'm Shiva Prasad. I operate in robotic surgery in Pomona Valley Hospital, also Citrus Valley Hospital. One question that was asked is, can you work from home? Years ago, it has been demonstrated that you can stay in one place and patient can be in a faraway place in a different country, can operate. Even in India, it has been demonstrated that the surgeon was in Germany and they did the surgery in Madras, the robotic surgery. So it has been done, proven, feasible, there's no problem. Whenever any new technology comes, you can't stop innovation. You, software technology, you know that. When a new thing comes, you can't stop Apple producing the iPhone, right? Anything, any technology, I'm just giving an example. So you can't stop a surgeon sitting in one country and operating in the other country. Impossible. Nobody can do that. The only way you can stop is by the regulation. So when the intuitive company got the clearance from the FDA for clinical use, FDA gave the permission that the surgeon must be in the same room as the patient. If I want to operate, keep the patient in room, next room, just door outside, I will sit and operate. No, FDA did not give approval. So in the US at least, you cannot have telesurgery. Your surgeon must be in the same room as the patient. It's the FDA regulation. You know, nobody in America violates the FDA principle. You will lose the license. But it has been demonstrated and proven that you can stay in one country and operate in a different country. That is one. Second question, biggest drawback of the robot is the cost. Why? You know, again, everything is legal in this country and in this world. Intuitive Surgical is the only company in the world who has all the patents. There's no competition. The day patents expire, the Chinese can produce the same robot for a fraction of the cost. But they have all the robot, all the patents of the robot, they have it. A few companies started manufacturing the robots, but the Intuitive took them to the court, and they lost the court, so Intuitive has all the robot patents. So maybe in the foreseeable future, there is no competition. So prices will not come down. And as I said, my nephew, that as a surgeon, whether I operate on the robotic surgery or laparoscopic surgery, the amount of money I get paid is the same. I do robotic because I believe it helps in the patient care, but for the monetary reasons, I cannot take robot because the insurance will not pay me extra money, either to me or to the hospital. So the amount of reimbursement remains the same.
But the hospital... this is more profitable, right? Like the effort involved is relatively lower.
In generally, you have the robot and hospital can advertise that we have a robot.
Yeah.
Plus more patients try to come there, more surgeons bring the patients there. But for each given procedure, if you do a cancer operation, whether you do a robot, without robot, the amount of money paid is the same. So there is no monetary benefit to go for a robot.
What about in India? Do you get paid more?
So the contrast is that only about 10 to 20% of the population has insurance. So it's a patient choice. So the patient is willing to shell out more, he will get the treatment or else he won't get it. So there's nothing, there are no robots in the government hospitals. So maybe a few, one or two central government related aided hospitals have it, but it's not economically successful in those hospitals. It's just the hospitals have it just because they're giving better care for the same money. Overall, if you give better care, more patients will come to you. That's the point of driving the technology. It's not for, actually it does not directly make money. In fact, many of the hospitals in the initial period lose out money. So maybe it helps in the long term. So.
Can you suggest us do's and don'ts in a daily
life? Oh, for cancer, preventing cancer. So two parts of prevention and screening. It's called, screening is for early detection. So prevention, it's very simple. There are very few cancer directly proven to be cancer causing agents. For example, tobacco, all forms of tobacco and alcohol. When tobacco and alcohol are simultaneously used, they have a synergistic effect of causing cancer. And then obesity, then there are certain infections like the hepatitis B and the human papilloma virus. These kind of infections also, when they're in the body for a long time, they tend to cause cancers. So you are able to modify, these are called modifiable risk factors. So if you avoid these substances, that's a good thing. But you can avoid only about 20% of the cancers this way. So only 20% of the cancers have a reasonably explainable cause. The 80% of the cancers, it's just your bad luck that you get cancer. But if you can avoid all this. And in addition to that, healthy lifestyle, just to prevent this, foods with lots of antioxidants, so a lot of fruits and vegetables, avoiding processed meats, avoiding salt. In Andhra, for example, we have a lot of gastric cancer, which is not very common in the rest of the world. That's because of the spicy food that we eat, a lot of pickles and salt in them. So that's a specific thing for like Telugu, and then eating healthy food and active lifestyle, that's it. And that's the prevention part of it. And then coming to the screening part of it, especially if there is some family history of somebody who has cancers. And if there's a strong family history, one odd person having cancer is not so. Sometimes there's a clustering of cancers in the family. In those cases, there are specific, you need to undergo some genetic tests, whether you have that kind of genes, cancer-causing genes in the body, and then they have to be watched more carefully. For example, this example of Angelina Jolie. Her mother had and her aunt had, so both of them, I think one of them succumbed to cancer also. So it's called a gene, there's a gene called BRCA gene, so this lady was found to have it, so she underwent surgery. There are many more syndromes like that, and which are associated with genetic problems. So that is one way to address that. You have these screening programs for the general public as such. For example, for breast cancer, it is better that you get evaluated by a physician, a clinician, and also get a mammogram done every year from the age of 50 years. The American and Indian guidelines tend to change a bit, but approximately every year or alternate year from the age of 40, it's better to get a mammogram done. And then these are cancer specific. So if you're, for women, we would look at, especially Indians, we would look at breast cancer and cervical cancer. So for cervical cancer, you can prevent it by giving HPV vaccination. It is recommended for children who after the age of 9 to 12, for the teenagers. So before the sexual activity begins, that they get HPV vaccination, you have to get 3 shots of that, just like any other vaccination, a DPT or a measles vaccination. So that's one way of preventing it. For early detection, you have what is called as the human papilloma, pap smear, the papanicolaou smear, which I think is very commonly done even here. I mean, advised in general, I think even the insurance will cover it here. So that is for the woman. For the men, they have to be really careful about prostate cancer. At around 62, from around the age of 60, men do tend to get a lot of urinary problems. So they have to be alert about preventing prostate cancer. So there's a test called PSA, prostate specific antigen. So that's a blood test. So that can be done, and also getting examined by a clinician. So these are specific to each cancer, the 3 or 4 cancers, so, which need to be very good.
Colonoscopy
for colon cancers. In India, colon cancers are relatively lesser as compared to America because we have a more fibrous diet. I think when people are coming on to, I mean, if your diet also changes to this American kind of diet with a lot of fast food in it, which lacks a fiber, then it's going to be a problem. The number of colon cancers are going to increase. Welcome to.
The child vaccine cause any side effect? If side effect, what needs to be done?
Child vaccine.
Actually, what are any side effects of the vaccine?
Is there any pediatrician here?
Actually,
maybe they
yeah.
should be able to. No, the reason is there is a, especially in US, I think it's good in many ways. But there is a specific propaganda coming up nowadays that vaccines are actually harmful. Even in India, if for example, my wife underwent vaccination when she was young and she had fever for about 2 to 3 days. So people think about the short-term complications. So the child developed fever, she was having she was very irritable, lethargic. So people are worried about the short-term problems, but that's the reason they are cancer-free for a very long time. I mean, sorry, they're free of that specific disease for a very long time afterwards. So vaccinations are generally very safe. Very, very rare events have occurred where due to some unknown reasons, they have led to certain complications. And sometimes things which are not in our hand, like strong allergic reactions or the anaphylactic reactions do occur. And that's a risk. With a benefit, I mean, to take a pros and cons analysis, I think the pros very much outweigh the cons. Vaccination.
Okay.
I think it is about the HPV vaccine. So actually,
okay.
We have a gynecologist in the house.
That's good.
Dr. Sudha Mula is a practicing gynecologist in Riverside. So
yes.
I thought maybe she can give her 2 cents about the HPV vaccine.
So brief thing about the HPV vaccine is it doesn't cover their 160 types of HPV. So the vaccine covers only for 4 subtypes, the major types. So I just had a patient and she's like, I took the vaccine, why do I still have an abnormal pap? Because it basically doesn't cover the whole 160 type. So it covers 4 of them, the one that we have right now available. It was just mentioned, any vaccine or any little procedure can always run the risk of infection. There is not a side effect that we know of. It is better to get it before they are sexually active. Again, they still have to be safe even if they get the vaccine because it doesn't cover. So contraception and safe practice is always advised even if they get this vaccine. It doesn't give them an immunity for everything. The fact that they have got the vaccine.
Yes, of course.
Dinner start chase, we can, while having the dinner, we can continue the question answers.
Okay.
And meet the online one also, you can post the questions on the website. I can ping me and we'll get the answers. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, sure.
Please, sir.
So
we have received a question online on WhatsApp, I guess. The question goes like this. I saw a couple who is a distant couple. Both of them got cancer and died because of that. And even in USA, I saw a wife and, who were neighbors of this particular person. The wife got cancer and she passed away, and after a couple of years, husband is having. So is the cancer contagious? That's basically the question. No. Cancers are not contagious. They do not directly spread from person to person. Very rarely, there are certain cancers which are like, for example, a human papillomavirus related cancers. If the husband has got infection, or the wife has got infection at a very young age, then infection get transmitted, and over years that after the infection got transmitted, the person may develop cancer. But that's a very rare scenario. So there is no way, you should not separate a cancer patient. You should give more and more affection, especially whenever you get your relatives or friends who are having cancer. Please do not isolate them.